Okay, this is the February 27th meeting of the Conway Selectboard. It has been an interesting 3 days. First item on our agenda is the minutes for the February 21st meeting last week. Has everybody had a chance to view the agendas?
Quickly.
The minutes?
Yeah, they look fine.
Look fine to me.
Everything's good? Okay. I'll make a motion that we approve the minutes for the February 21st meeting. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, thank you. Next item, meetings attended by select board members. Bob, what do you have?
So I went to the Capital Improvements Committee meeting on Wednesday, and we approved the two items that we had that we were looking at, so meaning they will get support from the Capital Improvements Committee. And one was, what were they? One was whether we would support the engineering cost, the proposed engineering cost for the wastewater treatment. And the agreement was we would support half of it, assuming that they raise the other half from something like CPA funds. So the committee was not happy about supporting all of the cost. So that was the compromise that we were able to reach.
Okay.
And the other one was what we wanted to do about the grader, where the distinction was, is it the time to buy a new grader, or would we support the repair cost of a new transmission?
And what does that extend the life?
So Ron estimated it would extend the life maybe 5 years, but it's hard to say. Some other catastrophic thing could happen to it because it is an old piece of equipment.
Right.
But the original estimated 25-year life will be 5 years from now. So we voted that we would approve the $35,000 for a new transmission rather than the $240,000 or something for a brand new grader.
Okay.
And Ron felt that he actually probably has enough money in his current budget to support the new transmission without town having to pass any money at all.
Okay. All right.
That's how it works.
All right. Bob, did you have
no, other than I would like to thank the both of you for assisting this weekend in the storm damage team.
Huh.
We had worked our little butts off.
Yeah.
And everything came out great. Now, unfortunately, we did get some town citizens that got a lot of cleanup to do, but everybody's safe, everybody didn't get injured, and that's the most important thing.
Yep. Yeah, absolutely.
But we don't have to do this too often.
Yeah. Okay, I attended a Franklin Regional Council of Governments Executive Committee meeting last Thursday, and the major topic of conversation was the Franklin County Emergency Communication System, which is being held together with basically Band-Aids right now, and the discussion was basically, do we put more money into the present system or try to get the state to take over the system or get money from the Department of Homeland Security to put in a whole new system. So there are some significant problems with the emergency communication system now. It looks like most people were favoring patching the old system until we can get some sort of a definite commitment from the state or from the federal government on providing funds for a new system. So that's where that was. And again, you know, we've had, since Saturday, we've been in meetings almost constantly to make sure, as Bob said, everybody was safe, and we were helping our residents get through this period. And we have a great debt with the state agencies. The Baker Polito administration did a tremendous job in getting those agencies to us, and they did a wonderful job helping us with the things we needed to do to keep our residents safe and ensure their welfare over this period. We also had tremendous municipal support, mutual support from surrounding towns, all of whom were ready to kick in and help us in whatever way they could. So it was really, really a great team effort. Our town administrator, Tom Hutchison, is on vacation down in Vieques. He's down there sipping Mai Tais. And we were lucky enough that Patricia Vincasey, who's a resident here in town, and the town administrator in Scituate, volunteered to help us because Tom was away, and she was a tremendous help because she goes through many emergency situations in Scituate because of their location on the water, and they often have things going on that are emergency situations because of that, because of storms and high tides and the like. So she was very experienced at helping us through the last couple of days, and we absolutely thank her and appreciate her help for that. So that's been happening over the last 3 days. We think we're pretty much out of the woods now. Certainly as far as public welfare and safety is concerned, we have a lot of cleanup to do, but that's not an event that's life-threatening at this time. So that's been the last couple of days and the last week. Do we have any citizens' concerns? Bryce, do you have a citizen's concern?
No, I'm here for new business.
Oh, I know. But I just wanted to make sure you didn't have any citizens' concerns besides the reason you're here.
Well, I do. I just want to say I think that the select board, the members of the town, did an outstanding job over the last couple of days. It's certainly not something that you plan for or even train for. So I think we're very lucky that despite all the damage, no one was really hurt.
That was unbelievable. If you see, you see some of the damage here in the center of town. If you went out to Main Poland Road and saw the damage
right there,
yeah. I don't know whether you had a chance to do that.
Not yet. Wait till they open it.
Tremendous yeah. damage out there. And luckily, the strength of this tornado wasn't that strong when it hit the center of town because it would have caused tremendously more damage.
Absolutely.
So, it was a blessing in disguise, and certainly because no one was injured or hurt, we're, very thankful.
Correct.
Thank God for that. But, thank you for your compliments as well. We had tremendous help from the state.
I could tell. I could tell. It was amazing to see all the trucks and cars here.
Yeah, and certainly IMAT, the Northwestern incident management team that's based up in Greenfield. Uh-huh. They were super.
Great.
And Eversource was great.
And Eversource, after a slow start, Eversource got on it and did a good
right.
job.
Great.
Did a good job. Okay, we don't have any old business. We have new business, and that's you, Bryce.
Yes, I'm here to ask you to sign a proposal by Goss Construction for starting the energy upgrades to the town hall. We've sort of gotten this down to be able to use the same amount of money that we were qualified under the Green Communities grant, and would be able to insulate the trench pipes, do window sealant, insulate the top of the gym walls, the cavities there, do a dense pack cellulose on the gym ceiling, then do some work on the sub-attic and the main attic as well as take care of the kitchen stove vent when we're done.
Okay. What we'd like to do, because none of us have reviewed this in detail.
Right.
And if this isn't critical for tonight, we'd like to table this until next week. We'd like to have Tom review this as well.
Very good.
Okay, is that okay?
That's fine.
Okay.
Hate to do it, Dean.
Not at all. No, I understand. I'm glad that we finally got something we can work with on this.
Yeah.
Okay. Great.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bryce.
Well, have a good night, good week.
Thank you, you too. All right, we don't have finance until 6:30. Okay. One thing that we have a discussion, not anticipated. Well, we have a lot of things not anticipated 48 hours in advance that we'll go into. The first one of those is the discussion of Chapter 44, Section 31, expenditures in excess of appropriation. And essentially what this allows us to do, it gives us the opportunity in emergency situations, as this weekend presented, to declare a state of emergency in town. That gives us the right to spend money without a procurement process, so that we can do things quickly and swiftly in the interest of public safety and welfare. And certainly, this is the law that governs that. We were on the phone today with Terry Williams, and Terry Williams was told that we declared a state of emergency, and he understands that and says that's certainly appropriate for the situation we were in. So we kind of got Terry's blessing on that. He wished us good luck. And as I say, this is the section of the law that gives us that authority. So, and you'll see also there's a bulletin on hurricane damage that's made out to selectmen, city managers, finance directors, treasurers and accounting officers that goes further into detail on, you know, what can be done with this particular part of the law. So we were in very appropriate in doing what we did and declaring an emergency at 9 o'clock on Saturday night after it became very obvious that the damage was severe and extensive and that we were certainly in an emergency situation. So.
Good.
Anything that you have to add to this?
No. Okay. I assume there's been tornado damage too.
Oh, of course. Yeah, of course. Any emergency that you have in that situation. And certainly, as I said, we had many things that weren't anticipated 48 hours in advance that couldn't be on this agenda that occurred over the weekend. Again, we are very happy that no one was injured and there was no, you know, of course there was significant loss of property, but there was nobody hurt, which is the most important thing.
Could I ask Lisa how many calls she had?
Sure,
today?
Yeah.
How many phone calls?
There was a hurricane.
Well,
the tornado.
I might keep calling it a hurricane. Tornado.
I knew you meant the tornado.
Sorry.
That's okay.
I'm tired.
There were probably, between my phone and they were mostly forwarded to my phone from Tom's phone, there were about 20 messages waiting when I came in this morning, plus all of the emails that Tom got. He was responding to emails as well.
So you answered them all back?
Yep.
Great.
I was able to do that.
Anywhere you want to sit.
Anybody wants some cookies?
Of course.
I brought them back for you.
They never end.
You're good. You're really good.
I'm buttering you. No, I'm just kidding. Yeah. Literally. It's got butter in it.
We know that, too.
And sugar, right?
And sugar. It'll keep you all going. I know we're all about
that. Look at that. Is this your apple cake?
Yeah, that's the apple cake.
Oh, it's all delicious.
Let me get this one.
I'll take one of those. You're evil.
Sorry, I'm late. I ran over to the other building. I know it was supposed to be here, but I totally...
Well, it actually got changed to the other building for a while and then changed back.
Yeah, I think I missed that memo. Went over there, I'm like, blending.
So, Heidi, you have something that was not anticipated within the 48-hour time frame that you would like to discuss with us?
Sure. What do we want to do about the bank account and GoFundMe pages that were set up. Bob Armstrong and I's names were put on the GoFundMe page, which is growing ever so quickly.
Yes.
And currently the bank account that was set up, was already set up. The auxiliary had an account already at the bank that we keep for emergencies like this where we can have people deposit money into it. Mm-hmm. So we relabeled it to the Conway Tornado Relief. Started it up with a dollar. So it has money in it already as well. But it is affiliated with the auxiliary, so it's like their, it's a,
you know,
it's one of their accounts.
Mm, okay, so we've set up these two accounts.
Yeah.
And we've called one relief fund for Conway Tornado.
So we've called both of them Conway Mass Tornado Relief.
Okay, and we're collecting money
into locations.
And we need a policy as to what we're going to do with that money.
We need a plan on who's managing those two, and then also who's going, are we setting up a separate committee or what to dispense that money, and what are those guidelines for dispensing?
Yeah, these are some complicated issues, I think that we should basically ask town council for his opinion on this as to how this should be moved. My initial opinion on this, it should be a separate committee other than the Board of Selectmen to basically make recommendations on this. And we have to figure out, you know, is all of this money is this going to private residents, or is it going to the town in general, or is it going to be split? These are some of the questions that we have to ask and find out what exactly is legal in terms of doing this.
When we set them up, it was to collect money. The way we set it at these meetings earlier was that it was for the town and the private owners.
Okay.
But I don't know if that's possible.
Did we ever get an answer from Holyoke on...
I got a contact with a lady down there, but she's not until Wednesday morning, but she's more than happy to help me.
Because I'm sure that they've gone through the legal process to figure out how
that
should be done.
So,
okay.
So I have her contact and name, but she's not until Wednesday morning. So
okay, I certainly want to see some feedback on how they proceeded.
Sure.
And
you want to follow up with that?
Yeah, they collected money for a fire down there, didn't they? Is that what that was?
I don't know what the incident was, but
I think it was an apartment fire.
Huge one. But Pat said that they have raised $200,000 already.
Right. They've raised a tremendous amount of money.
Yeah.
And I just want to know how that channels down to the people and who exactly makes the decisions on that. Because we need to be, totally
I think we should
fair.
So we want to know how it was set up, how it was run, and how it's being dispensed.
So the way that we set it up was that Heidi can't take it out without me, and I can't take it out without her. So
the GoFundMe.
So GoFundMe.
So unless you guys run away together, we're okay.
That's right.
Okay.
Please.
Sure.
Yeah. So no. And it just felt safer to do it that way rather than have it just in one of our names.
Absolutely.
That's a great idea.
But that's just the way that we would withdraw the money from this GoFundMe account. What happens to it after that then is it could be coupled with the other.
We have to have a very airtight policy as to what happens after that.
In the meeting, somebody recommended using the United Way.
I heard that suggestion. I'm not totally sure that we want to do that.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm going to know.
They're
a great organization. I think that we want to be able to dispense it quicker than that and more directly.
And we want more control.
Yeah.
Because once you turn it over to one of those charities, you don't always have control over what happens.
Exactly.
Yeah.
No.
So.
What I can tell you is we've done this in the past for other incidents that have happened in town. The auxiliary has taken this on themselves in the past, and then we've been responsible for doling it out in the past.
The auxiliary has,
which is why we already had that account kind of set up.
Right.
So the auxiliary is willing to do any portion of that if you so wish them to, or they're willing to say, we can take it out of our transfer to account you have, and that'll just be that. It's really up to you guys as the town, because the town is essentially a client of this thing. It's not, usually it's a private landowner or homeowner that we're just dealing with, so like all the money's going to that one.
Well, sir,
this is many, and their town is one of the many, so...
Well, certainly, if the women's auxiliary has, or the fire department's auxiliary has done this before, and you have a policy set up for that, you know, and it's a good policy, then...
Yeah, I mean, we've done it, like I said, it's been individual, so we can definitely craft, and we would probably look to you for that guidance of how do you want to prioritize things.
Sure.
Why don't you get the information you need to get from Hoyle?
Yeah.
And your organization digest that and come back in to talk to us to come up with a game plan on it.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
And again, we could also do it separately because we have the GoFundMe and we have the bank account. So, I mean, we can either, that can be one pot or it can be the two pots.
Right. Right.
So, okay. I guess I would put it to you guys to think about that. And, mm-hmm. and do you want to collaborate that together and then dispense it? Or do you want to say one is for one thing and one is for the other thing? I don't know.
I think the board's concern would be that we have to make sure that it's being done fairly and unbiasedly and that the legal process is proper.
I agree, because there'll be a lot asking.
I kind of think that the more devastation or out-of-pocket expenses a homeowner would have because of this tornado would hold a priority with me other than some person that just lost a couple of trees over there. You know what I mean?
Oh, absolutely.
But does it take priority over the town salt shed?
Oh, the town what?
Salt shed.
Oh, okay. Mm-hmm.
I think we can prioritize the, within the town's people, we can prioritize obviously the more harder hit ones first and then the other ones later. That I feel we could confidently do, probably.
Yeah. Now you see the salt shed is totally covered by our insurance.
Right, so in a way, I guess, None of this money's for the town, then? It's for the townspeople?
The adjuster has been there today, and he's very confident that everything is fine with that, and they will replace the roof, and there's no big problem with that. So.
And that was the only major town
That was it for municipal buildings.
So in your mind, then, this money's more about the residents, not the town?
Absolutely. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So then it's just us coming up with a policy to prioritize how we would prioritize those people.
Right. Yep.
Just in case anyone's wondering, we made this account this morning, and right now it has $5,500 in it.
That's absolutely.
Are you
kidding me? No, it's absolutely amazing.
And there's people donating from all over the country.
5 minutes, it had like $500.
Yeah, that's right.
Thank God.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's fantastic.
It is.
Yeah. It's unbelievable. Yeah, unbelievable.
Okay.
Anything else you would want to see on that policy time frame?
We want to do that pretty quickly.
So we want to give enough time for money to come in and be built up and then start dispensing?
Before the money complete gets put in all the accounts, we need to have a plan built as soon as we can.
Okay.
Sure.
We can build a plan.
Then we can determine when this should be ended.
So we'll come up with a plan, and then I'll come back and present to you guys the plan.
Next week?
Whenever you'd like.
Okay.
I think I'm meeting you next Monday anyways.
Because we have to,
for something else?
Something to think about the plan is how you're going to disperse it, and to whom? Or are you going to ask for applicants? Mm-hmm. Or how that's going to be handled, okay?
Okay.
Yeah, they'll have to be paperwork involved, certainly.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. We want the money trail. We want the paper trail.
Oh, absolutely. Yes.
The money paper trail. Yeah. Okay, I think I got my homework on that.
Was that your idea this morning?
Yeah.
The GoFundMe.
The GoFundMe was another It was right after I came up with the account because we've always done the account. They didn't have GoFundMes back then.
That's right.
Newer thing, and I'm not exactly familiar 100% on how they work, but I'm going to go meet in Holyoke and find out.
Okay. Yeah, and. I've been involved in a couple of those as a donor.
Yeah.
And they've been very successful.
That's what I hear.
Very successful.
Yeah.
Surprisingly so. But you know, you get 1,000 people to donate 10 or 20 or 30 dollars,
and
that,
quick.
That goes up.
And a lot of the ones that have been doing it are like 100, so.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah. On a side note, it's been brought to my attention today by many citizens of the community, and I just want to put this out there. You don't have to make a decision today, but about whether we should be proceeding ahead with the plans for the 250th, or if we should be holding on that so that those resources, if needed, could be used. Money. Money has been earmarked for the 250th. We have not spent it, obviously, yet. We have signed a few things, but nothing that I don't think we couldn't probably get out of. And a few of the committee members are feeling like, how can we spend that money on that when people in our town are in need?
Okay, I think
I think it's too her. My honest opinion was okay. Slow down.
I think we could go ahead with the 250th. Mm-hmm. You know, we've been planning this for a long time, and we'll take care of the other matter on the side.
On the side.
Yeah.
I agree with that.
Yeah, I do too.
Okay.
Yeah. Right. There's a tremendous amount of work going into this, and we can do other things to help people in need.
Yes.
Yeah.
And okay. If there's other ideas for fundraisers, by all means, send them our way. We're all willing to help out in any way. People have ideas, you could just have contact me.
After we closed out a meeting, myself and emergency manager and Bob was involved with a discussion about a fundraiser for all the people that got injured, decimated by the storm, and including the church. And we were talking about that there may be a fundraiser being set up for them.
Already.
A combination of a fundraiser, how can I say this, Bob? Combination of a fundraiser and a
community therapy session.
Community therapy combination.
You know, get everyone together to let people express their thoughts, especially the people that were involved. But a lot of people have a lot of memories about doing things in the, you know, in Pumpkin Hollow or so.
Okay. So if maybe you want something, maybe something. Let us know.
Okay, maybe something along the lines of, you know, we've had the pre-town meeting dessert potluck kind of thing. Okay.
Our emergency management department is looking into that.
Yeah.
Okay. Well,
yeah.
So when you talk to him, if you want to let him know, I mean, the auxiliary does this all the time after incidents like this. So
if you would like to touch base with Mary McClintock, she's going to be the ringleader in this, I think.
Okay.
Okay. Anything else you have, Heidi?
No, I think that's it. So we're meeting next Monday, what time?
6 o'clock. We'll get you on the agenda.
Here?
There.
Yeah, there.
You're going to get on the agenda.
She's, yeah.
I'm already on it for the 250th, so I guess we'll just
talk
about it.
Good. Wonderful.
Thank you, Heidi.
Yeah, thanks, guys. Thanks
and thanks for all your help over the last 3 days.
Yeah.
It's been invaluable. You know, the cookies have been great.
Those are not thanks to me. I just stole them out.
Hey, so,
was it in
that
property?
Was next to a citizen from the town who dropped by and said, here, I bought you this. So,
oh, that's great.
Yeah.
What did Integrity do without you?
They survived today.
That's good. Okay.
They asked how they could help, and I said, you work without me today. And they did. It was good. I have 40 emails to answer.
Okay.
All right.
Thanks, Heidi.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Jim, do you have the rest of your committee coming?
I expect they'll be here, yeah.
Okay. I don't know how.
Do you think it's clear to them that it's here and not there, or will they think of that?
Well, there's also a sign on the door.
Okay, great.
There's, you know, we've had a couple of busy days here, so I don't know how in depth we're going to be able to get into the budget discussion tonight. What do you have to offer us on your views of the budget so far?
I'm still in listening mode, frankly, John.
Okay.
You know,
I
know that, I went to the Frontier meeting and picked up the packet there, and, you know, I heard, I saw what's going on with the enrollment. I mean, you know, our lucky year, I guess. but my 2 cents is that it's always the schools are going to always be driving our budget increases, and you know, we can level fund the highway, we can tinker with the highway a little bit, but it's, you know, it's just nibbling around the edges, you know? I mean, the school budgets are where it's all at.
The school budgets are two-thirds of our total budget.
Absolutely. Yeah.
And if they go up 1%, for us to level fund, we have to come down on our town side 2%. Okay? Yeah. This year, they want, what, a 4 or 5% increase?
5 for the grammar school and 10 for the, or just under 10 for Frontier is our assessment anyways. I mean, their budget's actually only going up by 3, but, you know, it's the assessment between the towns, you know, we kind of get, it shifts, the burden gets shifted around.
So you know. let's, you know, let's say it's 5%. They go to 5%. We've got to bring our town side of the budget down 10% for level funding. How do we do that?
I don't think you do. I think people who support the school need to stand up and, you know, make their case, you know?
Yeah.
She's from, can I interrupt for one second? Western Mass News. They're trying to do a piece on the fundraising piece of it.
Oh.
And she'd like somebody to talk on camera. I think that would be better from you guys.
What? Go outside, and you're a lot prettier than we are.
That's not the reason to be on camera.
No, come on now.
Be our guest.
Come on.
Are you sure about that?
Yeah, absolutely.
You know everything.
Want to vote? All those in favor, how do you doing? Say aye.
All right, I guess we'll see. I guess it's
out. Go for it, Heidi.
I'm paying you back, Dad.
Dad.
Oh, don't let that secret out.
You did a good job keeping that quiet today. Yes, you did. I noticed that. I noticed that. All right, so our, you have any other members of the committee coming?
Yeah, there's okay. Other folks that are coming. I have confidence they'll be here. Okay.
So, so we got this tremendous school budget increase. And, you know, there's also increases we need in our town side. So, you know, we're like... up against it here in terms of trying to balance this and trying to make it so that we don't stick our residents with tremendous tax increases, you know. And that's just to keep things basically the same, you know. Just keeps things the same.
In the school meeting that you went to, did they talk about charter school enrollment, charter school?
No, you know, I missed most of that meeting. I was there for the facilities presentation, Bob Lesko. Talking about the roof work and that.
The 29,000 in the tar share?
There weren't really any firm numbers when I went. It was a slideshow. Oh. You know, show and tell what the issues are up there.
Because the Amherst district has been having a lot of discussions about an increase in the Chinese immersion charter school that's down in the Amherst district, and it's you know, virtually bankrupting some of the towns. It's almost, you know, that the increase, if the number of students that are on the waiting list of the Chinese immersion charter school all get admitted to it because they'll now have room. The increase that they would have to pay that one school is more than their increase of their entire town budget in the town of Pelham.
Wow. That's unreal.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
You know,
I mean, that's the full school increase and their town and everything. Healthcare costs, their entire town budget increase would be less than what they would have to now pay to this one school.
So what is the finance committee suggesting we do as far as the school budgets?
Again, we haven't actually met as a committee, you know, in several weeks, so we've just been kind of in listening mode, information gathering. Mm-hmm. A few of us did attend, at least one member, I think, attended the grammar school's budget hearing also, so, you know.
Did you know about grammar school budget hearing?
No.
You know about that?
I didn't know about that. When was that?
It was a school committee meeting where they went over the budget. It was,
oh, okay.
It was the last school committee meeting at the grammar school.
We did, I don't remember reading it.
Weren't we invited to that last year?
Yeah, we were.
We were invited to that last year. Okay. Do you think we should be pushing back on the school budget?
You know, for Frontier,
The one comment that I heard at the, I don't know who made it, but it was someone from one of the other towns, was that if there was a year to look for more, for extra money, ask for more money, you know, like for the roof project, this was the year because the budget increase was, you know, relatively small. But, I mean, yeah, for the other school, for the other towns in the district, yeah, but not for Conway.
So know? Our enrollment is up at
Our enrollment is pretty much flat. I think it's going from 80 to 82, but all the other towns' enrollment is dropping. And so, you know, percentage-wise, it's shifting to us, you know.
Yeah.
And it's just a little, you know, it's just a little percentage, but it winds up having a big impact, so.
Have you seen our tech school budget?
I haven't taken a look at that yet, no. I think that was sent out.
I think I saw that last week. I think it went down a little bit. But probably because of enrollment.
Mm. Yeah. So what other suggestions do you have on the budget that you've gone through?
You know, I mean, like I said, we're just kind of in listening mode. I'm sorry, I don't have any suggestions at this point. I'm not sure what we were expecting to accomplish with this meeting tonight. Obviously, Tom's not here to present anything, so.
Yeah, Tom did a very good job on putting together that budget document.
He does do a great job.
You know.
Have you discussed town employee increases in wages since next year?
Again, we haven't really met in several weeks. We haven't discussed anything. You know, the last time we met, we were in front of you, mm-hmm. When we ran through all those different
right. towns. Do we know what the timing is to get the budget together? Have we got a few weeks to spare?
Yeah, we I'm sure we do. When's your next meeting scheduled for?
We don't have a meeting set, but we'll set one tonight, you know.
Okay. All right. Because
I mean, there's a town caucus.
That's
town
right.
Caucus
town caucus is next week. Yeah.
So, Maybe we'll, I don't know if we'll get together. I mean,
once we get a quorum,
figure out.
But, Roy, how you doing?
Okay.
All right, so you guys really haven't met. Alan, have you had a chance to go over the numbers and then that Tom gave us?
Yeah, a little bit.
Okay. Any insights?
Well, I just really would like to hear from the school committee on what's mandated. I mean, one of the biggest individual item increases for the Conway Grammar School budget would be an assistant position for special education.
Yeah,
so that's the largest individual component, so I don't know what's driving that. So it would be very helpful to get more information on that.
I totally agree, because I looked at that myself.
And the projections for the number of students who might be in need of the services that the school committee put together didn't show a drastic increase, so I don't really know what to make of that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And as for the Franklin Technical School, there is a slight increase in the budget proposed for the fiscal year 18.
Increase or decrease?
I think it's a slight increase, but it's marginal. Basically, it's level funded because of the percentage of the overall budget. But we were 7 out of 472 students or something, and so our percentage is minuscule, 1.2%.
Mm-hmm.
The main thing is Conway Grammar School and our assessment for the Frontier Regional School District, which, you know, there's a $100,000 increase, and we're shouldering a good portion of it.
Yeah.
It's a larger portion of the four towns. You know, about 90,000 of the 234,000 that's been proposed for the increase.
Yeah. Roy, any thoughts on the budget document that Tom put together?
Honestly, I haven't been through it as thoroughly as perhaps. I don't know if Jim, have you been through it? Okay, but I
this one that was on the table when we walked in. Is that what you're referring to?
No,
I haven't been through it.
Is there any change in what we got tonight versus last week? No,
same.
Okay. Well, I do have something that's been nagging at me, that particularly in light of, this is going to be a little, I was part of a federal, I'm involved with another organization that has federal oversight, and they had there's a three-year operational site visit that occurs with this organization. And some of the thing, and this organization has a really excellent CFO. Everybody knows that this individual is, it's one individual, okay? Regardless, the reviewers asked us to step back from a budgeting point of view, even though everybody knows this individual had seen this organization through some tough times economically, and they've really turned the corner. The feds came up, they said, do you guys have you're missing some very basic things here. And we kind of looked at each other and he said, yeah, things like, do you require dual signatures on checks over $10,000? Okay, now, I'm really directing this not so much at the town, because I feel like our own operational budgets are fairly well scrutinized, even though not down to this level, but it's at the school that I'm directing this at, where it's been this sort of black box that we rely on the business manager down there, we rely on the superintendent, we rely on our principal in the grammar school, and I left this thing kind of reeling. I was kind of amazed that these feds, because there were two things. There was this, and it's like, does anybody come in and request the checkbook and look at the checkbook to see where these checks are going? And lastly, have you folks verified that your payroll taxes are being paid properly? These are like three really, really basic things that just, and this is not a rinky-dink operation. I don't want to mention it because there's no reason to mention it, and I could mention it to you after, but it just struck me. I mean, this isn't a bare bones operation. They've got a controller, they've got a CEO, and yet, simple, the light bulbs went off. It's like, do we have these kinds of controls? Does anybody know what they are? Have people looked at the, have people looked at some of the vendors for, and again, the school is such a big chunk of the budget here that maybe it's time to really, really have somebody look at it. That's what's been happening.
A few months ago on the news, and I won't mention any communities' names, they found out that over a five-year period, they allowed the school lunch program to go over $400,000 in deficit spending.
Where's
now,
that?
One of the communities. It's like, who was watching that? Well, over a five-year period, $400,000
in the hole. So, I'm happy to go on the record as being in favor of whatever kind of tighter controls, not tighter control, whatever, we need to sort of, I feel like we, at least in the Finance Committee, need to educate ourselves as to what kind of controls exist. And the answer is, it's always, well, the school committee does that, so maybe we need to be more focused on the school committee.
That would be picked up by an audit? We've been talking about it, every two-year audit or a one-year audit?
Well, again, if it's a three-year audit, that's, but even, you got to go deeper than just the audits. You got to look at things and say, does this make sense? Mm-hmm. Here's a check for $5,000. I don't know what this is for. I don't recognize this name. We have to ask and find out.
Mm-hmm. So. Well, you see, that's one of the reasons why in town here, we would like an annual budget. Because you get an annual audit.
Yeah.
The auditors would pick those things up if there are irregularities that shouldn't be there. Okay. And it's for the safety of the taxpayers' dollars.
Right, but I don't think we're talking about the town.
I'm just using that as an example.
It's the schools because they've got their own sort of black box that they work in there. So
yeah, I don't know how they do it. I mean, the organization you're talking about, but in our community, we have three sets of eyes that look at a bill before it's paid. We have the department head that submits it. It goes to the accountant who looks at it and sets it up on the warrant. then the select board approve it, and then it goes to the town treasurer that looks at it before she cuts the check.
Yeah. Does that kind of thing exist in the school district?
Really, yeah, before you came in, you know, I basically made the point that the school budget is 2/3 of our total budget.
Yeah.
So a 1% increase in the school budget for us to level fund requires a 2% decrease in our side of the budget to level fund. And it's getting to the point now where every year we're looking at our side of the budget saying, wow, we have no room here because the school budget is crowding us out.
Well, then it's only, we're coming to the same conclusion in a sense. It's only logical that we screw, and I'm not...
Well, like I said to Jim before you came in, do we want to push back on this, on the budgets that the schools are coming up with? You know, like Alan mentioned, the one, a teacher's assistant, you know, is, do we really need that teacher's assistant, you know?
How big's the class size?
Well, I went to the committee meeting with, I always forget his name, the one that's not here, Tom?
Tom.
And
you went to the grammar school committee meeting?
Yeah. Okay. And they have one of the assistants for every class, they were saying.
Yeah, teaching assistant in every class.
Yeah, every single class.
Yeah.
Depends on the class size, whether, in my opinion, whether or not. You know.
Well, my grandson's in first grade, he has 15 kids. They have two... other teachers other than the first grader. So there's three teachers always in there
with 15 kids.
I don't know. That just to me seems a little...
Very interesting.
I don't propose to know what the federal... Or not, I mean, what a good practice is or what makes a... You know, we don't want to take away from the quality of the education. Lord knows.
It's too late... Right now there is, but do you people feel that in another year, before we even get to this budget time, or we get to the schools starting to build their budgets, would it be beneficial for the Board of Selectmen to ask the principals and the superintendents of the schools to come meet with us, and we can express some of our major concerns before they start to put their budgets together?
Yeah.
Yes, I think it wouldn't hurt. I think trends would be really important, enrollments, projected enrollment trends, particularly with students transferring into the school districts and out of the school districts. You mentioned about charter schools. And that plays a lot of havoc with the planning budgets because that's $10,000 that could be coming in or going out. And, you know, in a town with a population of approximately 1,900 people, that's something we need to know about.
Absolutely.
With these charter schools, but like you said, I mean, how soon into the budget process do they know how many kids are going to be charted out that they got to pay for?
That meeting they didn't seem to know yet.
So that means to tell me that they've probably got to set a block of money aside for that.
Well, the uncertainty surrounding the annual budget school, this annual assessment to the towns, especially from Frontier, has just, you know, there's no predictability there. You know, you got these fact. You know, you got the enrollment numbers changing every year. You got the way the state funding formula plays in. When they review the town's, you know, valuations, that plays into it, and they tweak it, and the funding formula is so convoluted. And then you add onto it things like, you know, sending tuition or whatever for charter schools and other things. At one point I was wondering if. I was trying to brainstorm how could we sort of put away some money, like in a stabilization or something, sort of smooth out the school budget from year to year. But I couldn't really come up with a. It's you're not going to spend any less money. You know, it was just going to like sort of spread out the increase over more years. It just I couldn't make it work. But I think the other towns, it's hard to get solidarity in the district when, you know, it's not all four towns suffering in the same year, you know, so.
Right. Suffering the same way.
Whatever happened with the sustainability The, remember there was like this study that we funded, well, I don't know if Conway funded it, but they were going to have someone from UMass starting to examine like the district, and Andrea Lamas was involved with sort of putting it forward. Did you guys ever hear what happened with that?
Yes. It was put on hold due to some snafu from the University of Mass,
oh, okay.
We were told.
It's probably in our minutes from left.
The school has approached the university, the person, the man that's in charge of that program, and he's trying to get his feet back on the ground with newer students, I guess, and hopefully going to get it off the ground again real quick, or fairly soon in this school year.
Okay.
So it was shoved aside or put on hold for some reason.
All right.
You know, in the end, you're to squeeze efficiencies out of the system, you're faced with greater regionalization, which most people at the outset are not in favor of. They like their local grammar schools. Other uses or multi-uses for underutilized buildings, you know, this is what other districts and other areas have certainly done.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you could, you know, there are, even though at the outset most people think there's no real compatible uses, but there are some compatible uses, and I just know that you can go on the internet and you can see examples of districts, notably in New York State, some that stood out in my mind.
Mm-hmm.
And the third piece is to really consolidate and sell off property. Now, whether that means maybe the town offices could move into the grammar school and we could sell off one of these buildings. I mean, that would seem to me to be a somewhat compatible use to that building. But I think they're worth exploring these areas.
You know, if we don't push back on the school budgets this year, we accept them the way they're coming in, our side of the budget is
designated.
You know, we have nowhere to go. We have to cut somewhere, and for level services, we don't want. You know, we're down to providing basic services now. We're not providing any luxury services to people, and you know, we've got, you know, police, fire, ambulance that is necessary. Highway is certainly necessary. We don't have too many areas that we can cut our side of the budget. So I don't see any choice but to push back on these school budgets this year.
Could we have a meeting with the school committee, especially with the grammar school committee?
We have to do something. Yeah.
Let's see. I would ask that committee about the aides. Like what's an optimal level for aides? And in the end, I'd still like to see, you've got to look at, well, what is it costing really? Is it 50 grand a year or something like that? Or is it 200,000 a year? I mean, you've got to sort of put it in some relative bucket. I mean, but you add up all the little things and, you know, you probably do come up to something significant. Still, I can tell you at the outset, it would not be significant enough for me because of the very fact that I guess I was broadening that. You could add up paper clips in the office here and something, copies it over the assessors, and you could add all this stuff up, but it doesn't amount to a hill of beans really when you compare it to the fact that, you know, the school is two-thirds and everything else is one-third. So the onus is on them, in my opinion, at this point in time, to really understand what we're talking about here.
Jan was there, and she actually questioned one of the FTEs, but I don't remember the answer, so I would ask Jan, because that was the first school board meeting.
We should get the school, our school rep and the principal.
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
Getting both of them down the table first, let's have a good talk.
Certainly one of the things that greatly affected the budget this year, especially on the school side, was the increase in insurance costs. Went up 9% this year. So being a labor-intensive business, you know, that really has an impact on the school's budget, and then they just pass it on.
And they also said the roof at the Frontier, they're talking
about. A capital item, yeah. We discussed that last week. They're looking for about $29,000 from us out of about $180,000 to fix the roof. Our share isn't that big, but that's a capital item that now we have to figure out how to fund, and that takes away from our own capital items. So
in the 2015 audit by Roselle Clark of the Conway Grammar School in the town, you know, one of the items that was addressed here is that the town is doing a good job with OPEB, other than retirement benefits.
Yep.
But they suggested a higher amount of continued contribution for both the Conway Grammar School as well as the town. And, you know, so I don't see that in this year's budget. So that's another kind of potential area of concern that we need to address.
OPEB is a tremendous problem for every public entity in Massachusetts. We're doing an okay job, all right? There are organizations that are not doing a good job. And it's one of these things that it's mandated that it be fully funded, and by the formula that it's funded is a worst case situation formula. So it causes that increase to be more than realistically it should be. And all you're doing is putting that money aside for those post-employment benefits, which are going up tremendously in that slice of the age population because of the fact that those people get health insurance and their slice of that goes up tremendously. Mm-hmm. So it's a real problem, real problem.
As the pay scale goes up, that means that number will continue to go up too.
Yeah. Yes, yeah. Well, that's right. Every time they go up a step or they get another educational increase, it increases that slice for them on a retirement situation. You can have somebody in first or second year teaching there, and the actuarial for their retirement is way out here, and you're trying to find it's a mess.
Yeah.
Okay. But it's something that affects our budgets tremendously.
Well, I know historically we have really downplayed OPEB just because we've been very comfortably able to meet each year's
requirements.
And so by trying to fund that worst case in advance, it does put a strain on the budget when you think about it.
Yes, it does.
So,
yeah.
So I'm not certain the wisdom of that requirement.
You're funding future needs
right
before you're funding it's present needs in some cases.
You would think the school boards would want to hear from the towns as to what their estimated financial standings for the following year are going to be before they even start building their budgets. But they apparently don't care.
They don't care?
No, they care. Well, they build it on last year's budget.
They built on their own last year's budget.
Yes.
Well, to be clear, when I got to the Frontier meeting, I picked up the packet and it had over a 10% increase in it. And I was immediately told, oh, we already voted to lower that. So they threw a bunch of E&D money at the, free cash, basically, at the assessment to bring it down, So
what's
excess and deficiency, the school's free equivalent of our free cash,
okay.
Right?
Yeah.
And so, that's one of the things that they do, on a fairly regular basis, I think, to tweak the, to make the increase more palatable.
What we would call their slush fund is their free cash that they're banking on future expenses on, probably.
Yeah.
If they have a good year, then they would use it.
So I recognize that they took that action, but, again, that's just tinkering around the edges. That's not really, making any cuts to programs or services or anything. I mean, that's really, I do think, though, and I said it earlier, I think, if there's going to be a big increase, you got to get the school, those who you know, there's a lot of support for schools, you know, I mean, this, a lot of, Conway Grammar School has really great, reputation, and, you know, when I talk to people, you know, there are a strong element, I think, in the town who's very happy to pay. They think they're getting their money's worth, and they're very happy to pay whatever, you know, it takes to have their school. And I mean, you look at it, town meeting floor every year, there's a very loud voice votes on, you know, approving school budgets. So, you know, I mean, we can push back and we can tinker with it, but when it comes to the floor of town meeting, you know, listen to what the votes are, and it's yeah, widespread, heavy support for the schools. I mean, it's obviously an operating budget, so it's just all they need is a simple majority, you know, to pass. But
there is a limit of what you can increase in your town budget. And, I mean, regardless of 2.5% or anything.
Right.
So we're not as close to it as some towns, but we're approaching it, and then you have to level fund. I mean, right now, we'll try to level fund, but...
You go for Prop 2.5 override, and then you need a higher vote threshold.
You get to the point where you can't increase your budget more than the 2.5%,
and then you need an override.
And no override. Where you cannot pass an override once you've reached your levy limit.
Yeah.
And then there are many towns that are approaching their levy limit, and when you reach that, then you only can increase your budget the extent of your growth. And we have no growth.
And we are approaching our levy limit very quickly.
There's a ceiling and there's the limit. I think there's two different
things there. I'm understanding that there's no override vote if you hit that?
Right.
Is that just that year or for the next year? Or, I mean, then when would you have an override vote?
You no longer can have an override vote.
But when would you have one then?
Well, when you're not at your levy limit.
But so you're going to vote to override because you know you need to override, or just in general principles? I mean,
you can't have your tax rate be more than $25 on a thousand.
Right.
That's the limit. $25 per thousand.
Absolutely.
Okay.
So then you can still apply $25 per thousand on whatever your new growth is, and that's your budget increase.
Right.
And in most of our small towns, there's no budget increase. There's no growth.
New growth. Yeah.
And so then you absolutely have to level fund. And if you haven't been getting used to level funding up until that point, you're
going to be there.
You're in trouble. Yeah.
So that's interesting.
All right. So let's look at the school budgets a little more closely. Because we got to do something, or our town budget is looking very bad on our side of the ledger here. So you guys are going to meet when again? Maybe next week.
Next week.
So yeah. So next week is the town caucus. I think is right. The 6th.
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
So
at 8:00.
We could meet before the caucus, right? Generally, they're sort of invited to keep them helping the quorum.
We'll meet next week before the caucus.
And then 2 weeks from tonight, we can really have a knockdown, drag out on the budget situation.
We can certainly aim for that, yeah.
Okay. Good. Anything else you guys have on the, any comments on the budget or anything?
Looks like we're gonna hit our winter roads budget pretty hard, right? With this cleanup.
Well, no.
Will that come from some other bucket?
We're gonna look for some funding from the state to get that done. The lieutenant governor was here today, and so was our senator Adam Hines and our state rep Steve Kulik. And, you know, they all saw the devastation, and they want to help us as much as they can. So hopefully, we will be in good shape in terms of that cleanup. We'll see.
Okay, great.
Okay.
Thank you.
You guys know that the roof on the salt shed was blown off? Did you guys know that?
Salt shed.
Yeah. But according to the insurance adjuster who saw it today, he said it shouldn't be any problem. So. Yeah.
So the walls are still standing?
Yes, they are. Yeah. But MEMA gave us an indication that they may help us fund the deductible. So that may serve us well. So thank you guys for coming in. And you too as well, Kayla.
This guy needs to be included in the guys.
I wanted to make sure that we're making a distinction to degree and lady. Thank you for coming in. Have a good night.
Thanks, guys.
Last week we had a dog hearing.
John, I don't know if you know, there's also a tornado relief account started.
Yeah, we do know.
Yes. Yeah, it was great. Yeah, right. Thank you.
Yep.
Last week we voted, we had a dog hearing to have Mr. Moriarty restrain or confine his dogs. And this is a more formal format for that order. Have you seen it? Any changes that you want to make?
Just needs our signature.
It just needs our signature.
Is that
so.
I haven't seen it, but that's probably just a reassurance of our bylaws.
Yeah, all this does is formalize what we did last week and officially notify him in writing that...
Well, that's when you sent out those...
This is the same thing I sent out to you.
Good.
So essentially this will go out in the mail to him as a formalization of our decision last week. So I'll just make a motion that we sign this, okay? Any second, all in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Yeah, it was almost minutes of the meeting, which was good, and came to the conclusion that they're a nuisance and that they need to be restrained.
Yeah.
Any idea whether they're actually being restrained?
We haven't gotten any complaints.
Yeah, there's nothing. So.
So perhaps we're doing okay. Lisa, would you get that in the mail tomorrow?
You should make us a copy of that. I have
another copy.
Okay.
Here, Lisa, take this one. Stick this in the record. Okay. Concerns of the selectmen. Do we have any concerns?
Well, I had one other thing that perhaps is something to not consider within 48 hours, but do we have to take action on rescinding the state of emergency?
No, we're going to stay in the state of emergency.
Still, it could be incurring some expenses. So
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
We have to hold off.
I see. Great.
We don't want to rush to come out of that state.
After this evening, Ken may need some more police details that we have to pay for.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, we don't know what might happen a week from now that we might need to think about in terms of finances. Okay, I don't have any mail. I don't have any more announcements. Next meeting is scheduled for 6:00 in the town office next Monday, just before the town caucus.
Just before the town caucus. Town's caucus, 8:00.
Yeah. Is there any other business to come before the board? No. Okay, I'll make a motion that we adjourn. Second.
Aye.
In favor?
Aye.
Okay.